Hello, my name is Andreas Tesch and I'm the Chief Market Officer of Atradius, a leading global credit insurer. I'm pleased to welcome you to this first webinar in a series of virtual events focusing on key business topics and trends which are impacting businesses today and in the future. We have some fantastic speakers who I'm confident will provide some thought-provoking discussions. I've known Emma Marcegaglia for many years and admire her for her entrepreneurship, her push for innovation in an old economy, and her successful globalization strategy out of the small village of Gasoldo in Italy. Based on this entrepreneurship, she's been a challenging but always constructive partner in our negotiations. Being a constructive but still challenging customer also holds true for Johan Melander from Electrolux. I've lively memories of our discussions and negotiations in Stockholm, Brussels, and last time in Beijing. I'm still due, though, to meet him in his current base in Bangkok. Very happy to have them both on board today, as well as Ian Goldin, Oxford University Professor of Globalization and Development, as an external expert, and my dear Atradius colleague, Edwin Kuhlman. Before we get started, I would like to introduce you to our moderator for the virtual series, Daisy McAndrew. Daisy has vast experience working as a journalist, having been an economic and political editor for the likes of the BBC, Sky News, ITV, and Euronews. We are very fortunate to have her on board to help facilitate our webinars.
I'm going to dive straight in. We know that COVID-19 has changed so much. Look at us right now. We're talking to each other via Zoom. We're not in the same room, but what's it done to trade? Has it changed trade forever? Ian Goldin, has trade changed forever?
It hasn't changed trade forever, but what it has done, it's compressed into a pace of 1 or 2 years, events that would have taken 10, 20 years to emerge. So it's accelerated the trends. It's forced us to think much more urgently about the changes. And there's some key dimensions. As we've seen, many people have talked about deglobalization. This isn't happening. In fact, we, in many respects, have more globalization. We've seen that in the vaccines. Of course, the spread of this terrible pandemic is one underbelly of globalization. And we'll see it in mergers and acquisitions. We'll see it in financial flows. And we're seeing it in some dimensions of trade, container rates, higher than they've ever been in many, many routings. We're seeing the acceleration of automation and robotics that was happening, the composition of supply chains changing as a result of that. Increasingly, we will see firms hedging their bets. And obviously this is at the core of what Atradius works about, having multiple locations. We're seeing much more location in and near big markets, with automation and robotics being a big part of that. And we're going to see, I think, a very different composition of financial flows around the world, much more official flows and increasingly flows from Asia.
Ian, thank you so much. You also mentioned this shift to the east, that we're all, you know, that's been accelerated.
I agree that what happened also in the corporation is that we had to move very fast. I think the successful companies has been the one who understand what was going on. We're very agile. We're very fast in changing things. Just I want to make an example on our company. You all know that Italy has been the first, Western countries that had the pandemic in March, April. So what we have done is to understand this, to move very fast, understand, okay, Italy is closed. Let's go and sell the most possible, volume to East Europe that is still open. Then, when Italy was reopened, there was a very strong increase in volumes. And so we sold everything there. But of course, maybe then we will elaborate more on that. We understand that you have to diversify to your supply chain. You have not to, be dependent only on one supplier. So we change a little bit the way we produce. But honestly, we think that globalization will go on. And another thing which is very important, I saw some researches that say clearly that who is more internationalized, the company that are more internationalized, the company that are part of a global value chain, are the one that you know, did better than the other that only work for national markets.
Emma, thank you. Johan, coming to you, you are personally based in Bangkok, but of course the organization you work for is a proper multinational. How have these mega trends affected you, or how have you seen them come about?
I would like to pick up on a thing that Emma touched upon. And one of the things that we have seen happening is that we cannot rely on a single sourced supply. So we see that. We also see that there, as Ian pointed out, there has been this acceleration. So, I mean, in our world, we sell 50% more on e-commerce this year, 2020 than 2019. and that is huge. And it's coming faster than we thought. But something that's also good, that is, it's more sustainable. At least the consumers that buy our products buy them because we have more sustainable products, and we see a shift in the interest. So all in all, the shifts we have seen during this period have accelerated, and the differences in handling by different governments have impacted the markets and the people living in them.
Ed, I just want to bring you in. Obviously, feel free to comment on what our three panelists have said there about how things have changed as a result of COVID. But also, I'd love to know, looking at this year, looking at 2021, where do you see the big opportunities, both for markets and for sectors, Ed?
And the opportunities we see, first, I think I need to look back a little bit, and we have seen the sharp decline in the GDP growth in many markets in 2020. But at the same time, and I think Johan was also mentioning that, we see countries and regions that have kept the virus well under control. As from the start, they took strict measures and implemented strict lockdowns if necessary. And combined with the situation that we see the vaccination programs are starting or will be rolled out in the coming months, also in the emerging markets, we expect that the economies will slowly reopen and the increased demand and growing exports will stimulate the GDP growth in all of these markets. And quite by coincidence, our economists have just published an interesting report on promising emerging markets for 2021. And I want to touch upon that as well a little bit, because to identify those markets, they looked at three criteria. First, the pace of the GDP recovery after the pandemic. Second, the relatively low number of COVID cases, like in Thailand, for example. And also if countries have a relatively stable political and institutional condition. Well, having these three criteria in mind, we concluded that the best prospects can be found in Asia, especially in Southeast Asia. And that is also in line with what Ian mentioned. If I switch to the interesting sectors, I think we see a mixed picture. Overall, we can see that roughly one third of the companies are badly affected by the pandemic. One third of the companies are not really hit. And the other third of the companies are truly benefiting from the effects of the pandemic.
Thank you very much. Really interesting. Some real food for us to get our teeth stuck into there. So thank you so much for obviously a lot of that research you've done. Now, Ian, you kicked us off this morning with some really interesting insights into how the world, business world, global world has changed as far as COVID is concerned. Just picking up on some of those points that the other panelists have said and that panel, overwhelmingly positive. And also what Edwin was saying there about, and picking up on what you said, the shift east. I wonder if you have any comments.
Yes, I think it's important to see these as significant, but one or two things we need to be aware of, which will shape whether these are long-term trends. The first is we're not managing global risks. So unless there's more globalization of governance, unless people coordinate more, we're going to have another pandemic, we're going to have escalating climate change, we're going to have other crises, which will disturb these trends. And secondly, as Emma has highlighted, this has been associated with growing inequality. And that leads to populism, that leads to pushback. What we saw after the financial crisis was the rise of populism in the US and in the UK and Europe. We would not have had Trump in the White House or Brexit in Britain if it hadn't been for the financial crisis. So these crises have real political consequences. I was also very taken by what Johan said about the greening of preferences and their products. That will be very significant too. Already we're seeing relocation, for example, away from Japan. You know, Japan is not able to go into green energy as rapidly as some other countries. It's highly reliant on fossil fuels. And already some global supply chains have moved away from Japan as a result of that, because big companies like Apple and many others are saying we will only now take supplies from renewables that are powered through energy systems which are renewable. And that begins to, as climate becomes a bigger and bigger deal, and we say for our consumer products we want to go to net zero by 2050, companies are going to have to locate thinking about that in their supply chains, and that could also shift these trends in significant ways.
And I wonder, just picking up on what you've already said, touched on a bit about how consumers are behaving and how they're feeling about the world and how that translates into their behavior and their purchasing.
I can only talk from the perspective that I have, and I think that resonates with the consumers that can afford it. And fortunate for us, in my view, is that that is the target group we have. We are not the low end of the market. We are a premium brand that are innovative and sustainable and work to make life more enjoyable through our products.
Emma, I want to pick up on supply chains with you as well, but also just picking up on what Johan was saying, that's very interesting. Many people assume that when we're in a crisis and we're fighting for our lives, our health, our livelihoods, you know, that actually sustainability, responsibility, green environmental issues would fall down people's priority list. But perhaps that's not the case.
I think it's very important that in a moment like this, we really coordinate among us. So from a political point of view, from a business point of view, because other emergencies will come. Maybe we hope not, but a pandemic or someone is saying that cybersecurity will be the next pandemic. And I think, as we said before, COVID-19 has shown we have to take responsibility. And it's very clear that also, from a business point of view, we have to take responsibility on inequality, on climate change, because of course government has to make their part. But without, investment, technology, research of the corporates, it's not possible to solve the problems of climate change, of inequality. Supply chain, as I said before, we will also, choose our supplier also. Of course, they have to be efficient, they have to be diversified, as I said before, but also this part will be very important in terms of, looking at, sustainability and also social sustainability and climate sustainability. And so I think there is a strong move on this. And this could be also, a better come up of the pandemic. I also feel that 2021 for my business, for my company, will be a very positive year, will be a year of growth, more volumes, more EBITDA, but also probably a year where our growth will be more sustainable.
It occurs to me that who are the real leaders, the real global leaders in the world? And I want you to just think about that for a moment. Has the power shifted away from politicians towards business, global business leaders, who, of course, many of whom have much more money than the politicians have to spend? Many, many companies now are worth much more than the GDPs of some of the bigger nations.
Yeah, that's right. In fact, about 20 people have more money than 4 billion people and 150 countries. So it's certainly individuals, not countries, that have a lot of money. I think the pandemic, however, has swung the pendulum back to the power of governments. I think it really does mark a very strong shift from the 1970s when we saw the pendulum swing away from governments with Thatcher, Reagan and others towards individuals and companies the other way. 50 years after Milton Friedman, I think he really is dead, died. And that's because naturally pandemics require very strong actions by governments, whether it's in the lockdowns, whether it's in the support for firms and individuals through massive quantitative easing programs of governments, through basically banning bankruptcies, through furloughs, through unemployment insurance schemes. The private companies aren't able to do this. And the big question is this going to be sustained? This is not about democracies versus totalitarian companies. We've seen some very successful totalitarian governments like China, and we've seen some disastrous democracies like Brazil and the US in terms of the handling of the pandemic. It tends to be a case that women leaders have been more effective than men. So that seems to be one clear trend that's emerged, but they tend to be small countries that define that. So I think we're still gonna see the shakeout from this. Short answer is, I don't think this has reinforced the prime. I think the pandemic, like all crises, basically makes government stronger. Now the big question is, what's next? We can't carry on like we are with the deficits and the lockdowns. So the big question is, how does this recalibrate in the future? But I think it's going to be very different to the 1970s or 80s in the way it ends up.
I just want to bring Ed back in, because we were just talking there with Ian about how these huge government support schemes have made government more powerful and have swung the pendulum from power, from business, back towards governments. But when those business support schemes, Ed, have to come to an end, what does happen to businesses then? How do businesses protect their cash flow? And what are you predicting about that next phase?
Yeah, it's very interesting, Daisy, and also Ian touched upon. Overall, we can say the stimulus packages were effective and have not led to a huge number of insolvencies. And actually, in practice, I was also surprised to see that the liquidity of many companies we reviewed during the last months remained very strong, even of companies that were hit hard by the pandemic. And that is not only because of the government support measures, but also because of the support of other stakeholders, like equity providers or shareholders who were capable of bringing in new capital, but also the banks have extended or brought in new loans. What we do know is that the government schemes and the government support packages will come to an end. But as we look at the moment right now, we see that the low pace of vaccinations and still in many countries the lockdowns will be extended. So I think that it will take a little bit longer before the actual recovery starts, and as a consequence, the support measures of the government will be extended or only gradually brought down.
Yeah.
So and your question about the cash flow, yeah, I think. Very, very remarkable to see is that also an experience I had and we had as Atradius after the last global financial crisis, is that when the economy is recover and especially in the first 1 to 2 years, that is the moment where you still see that companies face difficulties and you see a high number of distressed companies and defaults because companies have less buffers. Have postponed certain critical investments and have difficulties in absorbing setbacks.
Just thinking about all these issues that we've touched on, whether it's temporary, whether it's permanent, who now holds the balance of power, how consumers will behave because of how COVID has changed it. Putting all that into one pot, Emma, what is your number one concern or priority going forward?
Growth, even with internally and also by acquisition, maintaining a strong, financial strength, but also, having a lot of commitment on values. For example, what happened to us is that during the pandemic, we are a family-owned company. Our people were already very committed and working with us very strongly. But during the pandemic, this has become even stronger. And for example, my opinion is that smart working is something, of course, that we have to do, and we did it and we're still doing. But in the long term, and this is also already happening, we would like at least in some moments to have all our people back in the office when you have to think about values, when you have to project, your future, when you have to, to work together and understand, making a brainstorming on what's going on in the world. We like to have our people with us. So growth, financial strength, but also core values internally and also externally.
And when we talk about working from home, that has a huge impact on your consumers, but also the vaccination rollout will have a big impact on your markets, I would guess, both the individuals within those markets, but also the different nations. And as Ian was saying, the inequality between some of the Western world who will get the vaccines earlier than some of the developing worlds.
And that is why agility is needed more than ever. We have found in Electrolux that our local presence makes us knowledgeable, so we can react locally. I worked with a global financial crisis, and I think the companies, thanks to the global financial crisis 12 years ago, 10 years ago, were stronger going into this, and there were tools and procedures and thought processes how to handle it. So thanks to the global financial crisis, we were better suited, better equipped, and including the central banks and how they have acted.
Very interesting. Andreas, welcome back, and thank you for joining. So with that, I want to say a very, very big thank you for taking part in the poll, sending questions. A big thank you to the panel, of course, and I'm going to hand back to Andreas.
I want to thank all our panelists for their opinions, for their contribution, and for a thought-provoking discussion, which has been largely positive. And we've seen that although COVID-19 has disrupted trade globally, it's fascinating to see how this has accelerated globalization rather than the opposite, which is what a lot of people were afraid of. And it has enabled certain sectors and companies to grow despite all the challenges. Thanks also to the audience for sharing your views and via the polls and telling us how you see the future. And again, it's encouraging to see that also our audience has largely been positive. It was my pleasure on behalf of Atradius to bring this event to you today. Thank you all for joining, and I look forward to seeing you all next month.